أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ورهبانية ابتدعوها ما كتبناها عليهم إلا ابتغاء رضوان الله فما رعوها حق رعايتها فآتينا الذين آمنوا منهم أجرهم وكثير منهم فاسقون. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. Respected elders and dear brothers and sisters, it is with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are together in order to learn something that should benefit us in this world and hereafter. In our last two sessions, we have been studying the concept of bid'ah in the Sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And today we inshallah finalize it as far as this series or this series in this month is concerned. There are detailed discussions in this book, Kitab al-Bid'ah, Sayyidi Shaykh al-Islam. And it has been translated into English as well. It might soon be out. It is in the process of printing. Today before we go ahead, we take a very significant point where a lot of people are misunderstood or mistaken. The question we start with is, where shall bid'ah take place? The answer to that is, the bid'ah will take place in deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This much is clear for us. A lot of people misunderstand the concept of deen of Allah, and they think that a few rituals that are the deen of Allah, and outside that ritual, those rituals like salat and other religious matters, outside those religious matters, deen of Allah does not exist. A lot of people think that. So when we speak about bid'ah and we give them examples, and they will say, this is dunya, not deen. Ma'adallah. This concept of deen, where dunya is not part of it, is not the sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. It might be another religion. It might be Christianity, it might be Judaism, I don't know them. Or Hinduism, or whatever. But it is not the sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. How do you define deen of Allah? What is religious in Islam? Everything that has positive or negative effect in your hereafter, that is deen of Allah. That is religion. Everything that has positive or negative effect in your hereafter, that everything is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the simplest way of understanding deen of Allah and the scope of deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I just give you a few examples. For example, Holy Prophet ﷺ said that there will be seven categories of people on the Day of Judgment, when there will be no shade available, for no shelter, no shade for anybody. Allah will grant them His own shade. And one of those seven categories He mentions in Sahih Bukhari and other books of Hadith. Imamun Adilun, just ruler. Now, ruling is deen or dunya according to so-called understanding. Being head of the state, is it religion or not? But according to so-called understanding, that is affected by the modern day Christians and Western understanding of religion. It is not deen, but Holy Prophet ﷺ said, it has a bearing, it has an effect, so much so that if you fulfill the duties, then on the Day of Judgment, you will be granted shelter. You'll be granted shade, protection. And in some hadith, Holy Prophet ﷺ has told more than that regarding this one particular matter. Al-imaratu amanatun. Imarat, headship, is a trust. وَإِنَّهَا لَحَسْرَةٌ وَنَدَامَةٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And on the day of judgment, it may come with a person in the form of embarrassment and in the form of shame for him. So that is deen of Allah. Politics is deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I'll give you another example. We are not allowed to use certain type of crockery. You know, like glass of gold or cup and plates of gold, it is not allowed in our Sharia. So the use of certain utensils or kitchen items, according to this understanding that we hear a lot, it is not deen of Allah. Ma'azallah, na'uzu billahi min dhalik. But according to Sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your items of clothing, if you wear this way, ma'azallah, you will go to fire. Do you still think that dress code is not part of deen? It is something non-religious in Islam? It is part of deen. It is not dunya. So this division of deen and dunya, a lot of people have made this, but that is a mistake. Very serious mistake. It is not related to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Certain items of food, is that related to haram or halal or not? Do you think haram or halal is not deen of Allah? Would you still think that eating whatever you like and however you like is nothing to do with religion? That is part of deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Clothing, eating, a lot of your fiscal matters, economic issues, are they not related to hereafter? So would you think that economy is not part of my deen? It is part of religion of Islam. So this concept, how do you go to bed? Is there any guidance from deen or not? Would you say it's a material thing? It's nothing to do with my religion? How to enter toilet? How to sit there? What to read when you enter? What to read when you come out? How to perform istinja and purification? Is that your religious matter or not? According to another religion, whatever it is, it may be non-religious matter, but according to Islam and Sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is within the scope of deen. It is deeni matter. How to eat, which hand to use for eating, and what are the manners, how to sit, how do you start, and how do you end, what way you eat, the size of morsel, for example, and things related to that. How much to eat. This is all related to our deen. So this concept of deen and dunya does not exist in Islam, in Sharia of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So bid'ah, this is one of the reasons. If you study the scholars like 400 years back, 500 years back, when they mentioned bid'ah, many of them mentioned the examples of permissible bid'ah. And they use the word ghirbal. That is sieve, use of sieve. They say it is bid'ah, it is allowed. It is one of the permissible bid'ahs. The use of sieve, if they have included that within bid'ah, do you think they have taken it out of Islam? So this concept is new to Muslims, to the literature of Islam, that this is deen and this is dunya. Ma'adallah, hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi. So we need to be clear on that from the very beginning. Now, second thing, from completing one thing that we mentioned in our first session, that we mentioned that that particular hadith, which is related to, which is quoted a lot, every bid'at is dalala, every dalalat is every muhtasa is bid'ah, every bid'ah is misguidance, and every misguidance is in fire. This hadith, we mentioned the background and the meaning of that hadith. Now, according to the scholars, of Islam in the early time, what was called bid'ah and who was called innovator? It might be very, very strange for many people. They say the bid'ati people are Khawarij. The people of bid'ah are Khawarij. Kharijites are bid'ah. That is related to their aqidah. And they mentioned Murji'ah, Mu'tazila, Juhamiya. Rawafid is bid'ah. And Allama ibn Taymiyyah says, the first bid'ah, فَكَانَ مِنْ أَوَّلِ الْبِدْعِ وَالتَّفَرُّقِ الَّذِي وَقَعَ فِي هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ بِدْعَةُ الْخَوَارِجِ. The first bid'ah that took place in the ummah, that is the bid'ah of Kharijites. So that is the type of bid'ah. And he also mentions some of their qualities. He says the Prophet ﷺ mentioned them in with the word hururiya in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. And he also and there is one hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that Rasulullah ﷺ's freed slave Abu Rafi, he says that when hururiya rebelled against the Sayyidina Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and they shouted the ayat of Allah, La hukma illa lillah, no rule except for the rule of Allah. No command except for the command of Allah subhanahu. This was their slogan, beautiful slogan. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala says, Kalimatu haqqin, true word, urida biha al-batil, meant for falsehood. Used for falsehood. So the use of ayat of Quran for the falsehood, this was their first bid'ah. And Sayyidina Abdullah bin Umar radiyallahu ta'ala in Sahih Bukhari, he used to say that worst bid'ati, worst people are the Khawarij. What is the evil thing they do? They take the yantaliqun ila ayat, they take the ayat of Allah which are revealed regarding mushrikeen and regarding kuffar, non-believers, and they apply it on Muslims. So the first bid'ah of Khawarij in the history of Islam, that is to declare Muslims as mushrik and kafir. That is the first bid'ah. And the Allama ibn Taymiyyah, people, ulama mentioned their aqidah, how they used to believe. And Allama ibn Taymiyyah mentions them in Fatawa, Majmu'ul Fatawa. And they declared Ali bin Abi Talib, Uthman bin Affan, and those who are with them, they declared them all kafir. This was the first bid'ah. And then he says, وَفَارَقُوا, Allama ibn Taymiyyah's word, وَفَارَقُوا السُنَّةَ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ, they left the sunnah and jama'at. So the first bid'ah was to leave Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'at, to go out of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'at. That is the first bid'ah. And then he also mentions they have two very peculiar qualities. Number one, faraqu bihima jama'at al-muslimin. With those two numbers, what they do, they left the jama'at of muslimin and their a'imma. One of them is going out of sunnah to declare, as I said, they take the ayat of Quran related to mushrikeen and apply them on muslimin, on believers, on Muslims. So one of them is to declare what was evil into good and declare what was good into evil. So much so, they were disrespectful to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then, again, I quote Allama ibn Taymiyyah. They say, "Wal khawarij jawwazu ala rasuli nafsahu an yajura wa yadhilla fi sunnati ma'adallah." Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. They declared it's permissible to believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam can go against his sunnah. Na'udhu billahi min dhalik. So they had their own understanding of sunnah, concocted, twisted, and whatever goes against it, they would refuse it. They would say it is not sunnah. And Allama ibn Taymiyyah mentions they refused to accept the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ with two, under two titles. Biraddin naql, they would say it is not hadith. You know, like we have in our times, fabrication. Fabrication, daif. They would say it is not hadith. They would refuse to accept the naql. وَإِمَّا بِتَأْوِيلٍ مَنْقُولٍ. And if they had to accept it, They will say, no, it doesn't mean this, it means that. I'll give you one example. There was this person, he did not believe that the people in the grave, they can hear you. I mentioned one hadith to him, Sahih hadith, that Holy Prophet said, and it was in Bukhari, that when you go leave your deceased one after burying them, they hear the voice of your step. First he did not have any reply, because it was in Sahih Bukhari and the hadith was Sahih. And after a few days, he brought an excuse. He said, this is related to that particular time. Now, where does it say to that particular time? So this is a way of refusing the sunnah. When you quote a hadith, they will say da'if, they will say fabrication. If they can't do that, they will make an excuse. So this is the first bid'ah in the history of Islam. This is the first bid'ah in the history of Islam. I repeat it. You see it a lot in our times. And the second one was Rawafid. These two, those who believe that Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu is God, is Allah. Na'udhu billahi min zalim. People exist today with this notion. For example, Jibreel was supposed to bring the wahi to Ali radiallahu ta'ala, and he mistakenly brought it to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now he continued to do that for 23 years, and Allah continued to allow him to do that. Na'udhu billahi min zalim. So things like that, there are extremists. So this was very important to know what is the bid'ah regarding that particular hadith, which says every innovation is bid'ah and every bid'ah is misguidance. This is that bid'ah. Going out of Ahlul Sunnah is that bid'ah. Now today, come to the next type. A lot of people think that the Quran has also condemned bid'ah with this ayat of Surah Hadid, that when it mentions the monks, monasticism of the people of Christianity, the Rahbaniyya, the monasticism, ibtada'uha, they have invented it. Ma katabnaha, we had not obligated that upon them. So they say that Allah condemns bid'ah. Well, this ayah doesn't say so. If you study the ayah, that it further goes, it says, فَمَا رَعَوْهَا حَقَّ رِعَايَتِهَا. They did not fulfill the duties regarding that bid'ah. They made mistake. They went to beyond certain limit. They went to extreme. In the matter of the bid'ah itself is one thing, and going beyond the limits in that one is another thing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, فَآتَيْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ. Those who had true belief in among them, Allah gave them their reward. With that bid'ah, Allah gave them their rewards. So bid'ah could be rewardable. But majority of them are transgressors. They go beyond limits. So when there is a bid'ah, there are limits. We need to observe those limits. So this ayah only says that when there is bid'ah, observe the limits. It doesn't go more than that. It doesn't say anything more than that. It doesn't say bid'ah is absolutely haram or absolutely just thrown away. It does not happen like this. This ayah doesn't say that, and we mentioned the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which showed that it does not happen that way. Now, before I go to the next point, we take from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmizi, many books of hadith with slightly different wording, this hadith has been mentioned, has been quoted. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man sanna sunnata khairin, whoever initiated a good path, a good custom, فَاتُّبِعَ عَلَيْهَا, then he is followed, people followed him, فَلَهُ أَجْرُهُ, then he will get his reward, and مِثْلُ أُجُورِ مَنِ اتَّبَعَهُ, and as much as the followers get reward, that all also will be given to him. So it is rewardable. And in contrast, says مَنْ سَنَّ سُنَّةَ شَرٍ, whoever initiates a custom of evil, فَاتُّبِعَ عَلَيْهَا, and he is followed, كَانَ عَلَيْهِ وِزْرُ, he will be he will get the sin, and those who follow him, their sin as well. So Holy Prophet has clearly said, you can initiate a good path, a good custom, and you can initiate an evil custom. But the good custom will get you rewards, and the evil will get you, ma'azallah, sin and punishment. And in one narration, Holy Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, مَا أَحْدَثَ قَوْمٌ بِدْعَةً إِلَّا رُفِعَ مِثْلَهُ مِنَ السُنَّةِ. The people never initiate, invent a bid'ah, except they remove one of the sunnah from their life against it. In this one, Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam specifies the meaning of bid'ah. Something new is not bid'ah according to this. Something new that will remove some sunnah from our life, like leaving certain sunnah, ma'adallah, that is bid'ah, otherwise it is not. It is not bid'ah shari'ah, it is lughaviyah, and that is good, as we mentioned. And we mentioned a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam last time, in our last session. I give you a few examples. There is, when you study the hadith, the science of hadith, they define what is hadith. And they say, مَا أُضِيفَ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, whatever is attributed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ فِعْلٍ أَوْ تَقْرِيرٍ. Three things at least they mention. The word, the act, and taqreer. What is taqreer? Taqreer is something that Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did not say and he didn't do. Somebody did in front of him and he didn't stop him. He didn't say, don't do it. Now that particular thing, before it was done, there was no direction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was no direction from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people initiated it. Some of the Sahaba initiated it. When they initiated, then Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at it, and sometime he said no to them. Don't accept that. Don't do that. Sometime he accepted it. And sometime he didn't say, appreciated it. Sometime he didn't say anything. So either way, these are three possible reactions. And we have all three in Sunnah. And that is known as Sunnah Taqririyah. So when he accepts such thing, because that thing before that happened, it was not a direction from Quran or Hadith, from Allah or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it was in its original nature, it was an invention, innovation. It was a bid'ah. And when Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam rejects it, it means this type of bid'ah is not allowed to accept. And when he accepts it, it means this type of bid'ah is acceptable, it is rewardable. And when he doesn't say anything, it means this type of bid'ah, either do or not, it is indifferent. Because we are only taking one type of this. Sahih Bukhari. There was this person that his name is Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu narrate that some people from the Sahaba Rizwanullah alayhim ajma'een, they passed by some water, and among them there was actually they were traveling. They saw water, they camped there, and they needed some food. And the people, the local people, they did not serve them. They did not host them. Some of them came and said, do you do anything regarding, do you know anything that should, because our master has been bitten by a snake. Does any one of you do anything to heal that, to treat that? And one of the Sahaba said, yes, I do, but you need to give me this number of sheep. They say, okay, we'll give you. And he went and he did the dam. He recited Surah Fatiha and blew on the bite place where the sting mark was there. And then he was okay. He became okay. He was treated and he was healed. Then they gave them those sheep. And they brought it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فبرأ, he became okay. فجاء إلى أصحابه فكره. Some of the Sahaba said, you shouldn't do this because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has never told us to do this. You shouldn't take these sheep from them. And he said, okay, you don't eat it. And then he brought them to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now this is an innovation, bid'ah. This is the reason some of the Sahaba didn't like it. It was not given direction from Allah or Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So it was bid'ah in this sense. When it was brought to the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. And they actually complained. And he said, إِنَّ أَحَقَّ مَا أَخَذْتُمْ بِهِ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. The meaning is that the most suitable thing that you take compensation for, you accept some compensation for, that is Quran. So you are allowed to do it. Now before he allowed it, it was bid'ah, and his act of allowing it is acceptance of that bid'ah. It's very clear. So this is sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever new matter comes, it comes to mujtahid, it comes to jurist. And he will either accept it or he will say, no, it is not allowed. And people will follow it. We mentioned that in our last session. And there is another thing, again Sahih Bukhari, that during Salat, Rafa'a bin Rafi says that we were offering prayer behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. During one rakat, he raised his head, he stood from the ruku and said, Sami Allahu liman hamida. One man behind him said, Rabbana walakal hamdu hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fi. This long. Falamman sarafa, when he completed the prayer, he said, Manin mutakallim, who said that? What does that show? It was not a direction from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before this. It was not sunnah. It was not Quranic order, but Sahabi did it. He invented something, he innovated something, and Holy Prophet ﷺ said, who is that? And this person stood up and said, Ana ya Rasulullah, I am the one. And the Prophet ﷺ said, I saw more than 30 angels rushing, running towards it in order to pick it first. In order to pick it first. To write it down first. So Holy Prophet ﷺ appreciated that bid'ah. And from there we have the word of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala, ni'mat al-bid'atu hadi. And in the books of hadith you find Salatul Duha, the mid-morning prayer, this is sunnah. You find Abdullah ibn Umar and other Sahaba, somebody asked them about Salatul Duha and he said it's bid'ah. But he didn't say never do it. So bid'ah itself is not a negative term, but unfortunately, illiteracy, ignorance of deen in our time, it has made it negative. Another example is that there was a person, Holy Prophet commanded him, appointed him to lead prayer in his local area. And whenever he would stand up in prayer, and he would recite his recitation, then at the end he would recite Qul Huwallahu Ahad. Then second rakat, he would do that again. And some of his companions, the musallin, they said, why do you do that? And he didn't listen to them. After some time, they came to the Prophet ﷺ and they complained. They were saying, if he had to recite this surah, why does he recite another one? Do it straight. And if you want to recite that, it feels that he does not find any part of Quran sufficient for prayer without this. That's what they felt, and they didn't like it. And they came to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Holy Prophet ﷺ said, your companions, your musallin are saying to do a certain way, why don't you do that? He said, Inni yuhibbuha. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I love this surah. And Holy Prophet ﷺ did not say, this is innovation, this is bid'ah, this is not my sunnah, I never do this. I have never commanded to do this. He didn't say that. He said, حُبُّكَ إِيَّاهَا أَدْخَلَقَ الْجَنَّةِ. Your love for this surah has taken you to paradise. So the whole, all sunnah taqriri, that is initially a bid'ah accepted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So on the basis of this, scholars have mentioned that the innovation are more than one type. They are more than one type. And we mentioned, just finish our session here with this. If you want to study the details, you will find Imam Shatibi, Imam Nawawi, Imam Ibn Hajar Makki, and Alama Wahidul Zama. This is one of the Salafi ulama in subcontinent. And you will find the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I'll give you the name of the scholars, the list of the name of the scholars. This book has 45 scholars mention the types of bid'ah. It's not absolutely bid'ah fire, na'udhu billah. It's not like that. And so they say there are five types of bid'ah. Number one, bid'ate wajiba, bid'ah that is an obligation. And they give the example, establishing dini and religious schools and universities, studying the Arabic syntax and Arabic morphology and rhetoric, and the sciences of hadith and the sciences of tafsir of Quran. This is, and the sciences of fiqh, studying all that is bid'ah, and it is bid'ah wajibah. Why? Because they serve a purpose, this is, which is an obligation. That is to understand deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't do that without these. So they become obligated. So depending on the purpose of Sharia it serves, bid'ah can be obligation. Then they say, one of the bid'ahat, which are obligation, is to establish new arguments according to your time and era against the falsehood. In the form, like in, from taking new argument from the sciences that are prevalent today, from physics, for example, from astronomy, for example, from biology, for example. This is one of the bid'at wajibah. Number two, they say bid'at mustahsana, mustahabba, rewardable, recommendatory. And they give the example, the building of lodges for travelers. This is bid'at-e mustahabba. As I said, they did not, in the history of Islam, there was no concept of deen and dunya like we have today. So they are giving the example of mustahab things. Salatu Taraweeh in jama'at, etc. And then bid'at-e mubaha, permissible. And they say, they give the example, shaking hand after Salatul Fajr. And now we do after every namaz, that is bid'atim mubaha, permissible bid'at. If you don't want to do it, there is no problem. And they give the example of cooking delicious meals. It is bid'atim mubaha. Holy Prophet ﷺ did not used to do that. You know, particular spices and a lot of things like that. It is not the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. That was simple. Very simple. So this is bid'ah. As I said, the history of Islam does not know deen and dunya. This is religious, this is non-religious. History of Islam does not know that. It's just this era's problem because of ignorance. Dunyavi and deeni. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And they also give the example of using fine sieves. They didn't used to have fine sieves. And I give the example of the mustahab. And sometimes mubah, these building mosque with bricks and cement. It is not the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is not sunnah in the time of Khulafa'i Rashidin. It came long afterwards. And the carpet, you find many scholars, sometimes they say that you are not allowed to put anything between your forehead and the ground. This is not the sunnah, but it is mubah. Permissible sunnah, permissible bid'ah, carpets in the mosques. Number four, bid'at-e muharrama, bid'at that is haram. For example, establishing new school of law. Like in our time, we have a new thing called Salafism. This is bid'at haram. And this is the sunnah of Khawarij, because they are the one who did it first. They established a new school of thought, ma'azallah. And bid'at makruha, dislike, prohibited innovation. To do anything, to establish anything that would let us or that will force us to leave a sunnah muakkada. Any such thing would be like some of the early scholars mentioned the example of decorating mosques. They say the reason for being bid'at makruha, disliked bid'ah, is that it takes the concentration away from Allah. It attracts your eyes. So it shouldn't be allowed in the mosque. So people, ulama, look at it from different angles and they declare it disliked or liked. Now the last point, when something new comes, then that is not the matter of the text of Kitab and Sunnah. That goes to the jurist or mufti of the time. And ulama do have difference of opinion. They look at it from different angles. When this happens, always remember, you follow the scholar that you trust most, but you have no right to condemn the others. Leave that to ulama. You have no right to condemn the others, because this is not the matter of text, like Mawlid. It is not in Quran, it is not in Hadith. But jurists, ever since it has started, jurists have unanimously, in the beginning there was a few difference, but later on, almost unanimously, they have said it is rewardable. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us proper understanding and following. And I hope it clarifies the concept of bid'ah and a lot of thoughts related to bid'ah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us proper understanding and following. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ.